I'm very intimidated to follow these two all, and I'm generally feeling rather honored and humbled to be here, and yet ironically, I probably wouldn't be here, as Charlie was saying, if I hadn't put myself in the crosshairs of this debate and gotten myself conveniently fired from my former place of employment. It's lovely to be in a place where people want to have a genuine dialogue about these topics. Because I'm coming from a more conservative cultural context, what I've found when people approach Humanae Vitae is that they tend to weaponize it. And you've probably heard this term before. It's used a lot in our circles that I come from. And I feel that this is inappropriate from a pro-life perspective, that one should be, that an encyclical teaching of the church should be used aggressively against others. But it's also just from a scholarly, ethical, and textual critic perspective, a very simplistic approach to treat a text as though it's something you can respond to by checking the box, do you agree, yes or no? And prior to coming here, I had a few people kind of attacking me on social networking and saying, well, do you agree with this? And I said, that's not a question that we can answer that simply. We need to figure out what does it mean. A text translated from one language into another, a text trying to capture complex truths about complex realities, and trying to figure out, you know, what is the divinely revealed truth here, this requires dialogue. And dialogue requires a genuinely pro-life attitude in which we're able to see the other as having dignity, not someone to beat over the head with an idea. And now this is also relevant from a leftist standpoint, because my social justice friends can sometimes be just as aggressive with our social justice beliefs as right-wing pro-lifers can be aggressive with pro-life beliefs, and this is a problem. And when I say that Humanae Vitae shouldn't be weaponized, I mean not only against those who disagree with it, but also against those who agree with it. If we have issues with Humanae Vitae, the correct approach, if we are Catholics who value this complex tradition, is to look into it more deeply. Now, one of the kind of aggressive articles that I saw going around was predicting terrible events just like this one right here, saying that people were going to get together and talk about Humanae Vitae critically, and that probably they were going to suggest that we go and find a deeper meaning. Yes, that's what we're going to do. So their worst fears are realized. So I want to address, I feel that Julia and Charlie have already covered so much. One of the issues that we face with the legacy of Humanae Vitae is the collapsing of two issues into one, the contraception question and the abortion question. And I think that the contraception question has to be taken away from the abortion question and looked at with much more careful attention to what is actually present in the text, and again, looking to the needs of faithful Catholics who take the teaching seriously and yet are saying, this is causing us profound difficulty. Listening to feminists, as Julie said, listening to married couples, and being realistic about the fact that right now we have what I consider to be a kind of dangerously artificial sex positivity in NFP culture, in which people tell you NFP will solve all your problems. The rhythm method, there are many different forms of NFP. I've even heard one of my former students who had endometriosis was informed by a male politics professor that NFP would cure her endometriosis. And so there's this tendency to fetishize it and and treat it like it's going to solve all of our problems. But then as soon as you turn around and say, well, wait a minute, actually NFP is causing difficulties in my marriage, people will say, well, marriage is meant to be a cross. So I'm like, well, which is it? Is it happy, wonderful sex all the time? Or is it you're being crucified all the time? Are we getting into a very weird realm of kink here? And I think we need to listen much more to the people who are experiencing it and who aren't trying to be irresponsible. People who love the church and who don't want to be promiscuous. People who are open to life. So another issue that we face has to do with the context of abortion as a life issue. And this is kind of what I've been emphasizing in my accidentally initiated organization, the New Pro-Life Movement, which I never intended to start. I want to be left alone to write about sex robots. I get very anxious when I'm brought into situations of debate. But what I found was that it was impossible for me to accept what being pro-life meant the way the people around me were describing it. But I also found it absolutely impossible to reject my belief in the fundamental dignity and sanctity of all life, human life at all stages, unborn human life, and also non-human life. I could not erase that from my head. And so what we've been trying to do in the New Pro-Life Movement, perhaps sometimes feebly finding our way along, taking counsel from those who have been paying attention to this longer than we have, is to make pro-life a much broader term. It does not refer simply to abortion. The reasons for this are several. First of all, accepting an ethic of life means recognizing the value of life in a way that is logically prior to recognizing the value of unborn human life. If we say, well, we don't want to recognize the value of these immigrants here, or this convicted criminal there, or this person who's disabled here, but let's really focus on the life of the unborn, that actually kind of looks like you don't believe in life. It looks as though that common criticism of pro-lifers that they're trying to control women is in fact genuine. But it's not just about how we look. It has to be about how we act and how we live. Second point, opposing abortion is not always necessarily equivalent to recognizing the dignity of unborn life. There are non-pro-life cultures in which there are restrictions on abortion. The case of the young woman in El Salvador who was jailed for a miscarriage. It is a culture which has rules against abortion, but it's not a pro-life culture. There were laws restricting abortion for German women in Nazi Germany. My own Jewish people, different matter. But you can see that simply making abortion illegal is not like, boom, we now have a pro-life society. Thirdly, I'm mixing up my numbers. Fourthly, I'm going to go on. Historically, abortion was not always viewed simply as an isolated moral issue in terms of life ethics. Historically, people who became interested in an opposition to abortion and using the term pro-life came to it out of a kind of hippie pacifist place. You know, we're already opposing war, we oppose violence, so wait a minute, why would we decide to correct the problem of injustice to women by committing another injustice? So for those who say that we're making some kind of wild leap here in making pro-life mean something new, one could say we're being very traditional. And I continue to come back to this idea that many things that are viewed as radically, wildly leftist and progressive in Catholic culture today are in fact very traditional. Care for the poor by the community is very traditional. You know, if we could have a Latin Mass and social justice at the same time, that would be lovely. There are also many, many other offenses against life that themselves contribute to the demand for abortion. So even if you don't think these other offenses against life deserve to be dealt with under the pro-life label, as has been mentioned, the reasons why women choose abortion, it's very rarely because you just felt like it, because it seemed like something fun to do today. Even when there isn't the pressure of poverty, when there isn't the pressure of instability, domestic violence, even issues of ecological injustice. You know, if you're living in a place that has severe contamination from industry, do you feel safe having a baby? If you look at the situation in Flint, Michigan, for instance. So all of these issues have to be dealt with if we're going to approach abortion. Aside from the fact that they're life issues themselves. Now, also there's just the rhetorical fact that if you are claiming to be a defender of life, and in every other respect, you are not defending life, that's not going to win any hearts. I would say even for those who don't care about the rights of immigrants, if you want, and this is probably not something I need to say to this group, but for those who are outside of this particular circle, I think it's very important to reiterate that an opposition to abortion, if presented in the context of an acceptance of many, many terrible social injustices, is not pro-life. It is no longer pro-life. How much time do I have left? One of the things that our organization has tried to do then is to look, and Charlie and I have disagreed on this just a little bit. We're focusing on abortion, reducing abortion, not by focusing on supply, but by focusing on demand. And this is not because I think that there should be no laws restricting abortion. In most European countries, there are much stronger laws against abortion than what we have. And I think it's interesting that these are countries which also supply much better medical care. I think that's incredibly important to have a social safety net. But the main reason is that, again, I cannot stop holding these two thoughts in my head. One, that the value of all life is important. And two, that a woman's right to bodily autonomy is real. And so I encourage people to think about this intersectionally. Instead of bracketing out one issue and focusing only on the other, think about how a woman's right to have a claim on her own body is something that we need to respect. The famous violinist argument, if y'all are familiar with that. What if you woke up one day and you found that you were attached to a famous violinist and he depended on you for life support, and no one's saying that the violinist doesn't deserve life, but hey, he's attached to you and you have a right to free yourself. That's an argument that's been used in favor of abortion. And my response to that would be, let's not have one or the other. Yes, the violinist has a right to life, and yes, you have a right to free yourself from this incredibly burdensome situation. We need a culture that will help you to do that without destroying life. And so that's kind of the first two points of the new pro-life movement. The rest is simply to place opposition to abortion in the context of other life issues, and you can look us up online if you're interested in that. I just want to close, though, by saying, again, we need to look at Humanae Vitae not as a weapon, but as a text. And that means coming together in dialogue to talk about what our words mean, and giving that moment of pause to listen to what the other person has to say before jumping on them. And I think that this culture is going to be fostered not just politically. I think the politics of a pro-life culture is important. We need to have, for instance, laws protecting immigrants right now. It's incredibly important. And we need to have laws protecting the environment, because in these cases, you can enact the laws without at the same time having this problematic, but what about the woman's reproductive rights? So I think there are some laws that do need to be enacted. But I think that much more deeply than this, we need to have a religious, an aesthetic, and a poetic cultivation of a kind of reawakening of the beauty of life, all life. I've said before, go and find a caterpillar and look at it until you see its beauty. If you get periodical cicadas, don't be annoyed by them, rejoice with them. They only have a short period of time to live. So that's kind of my Franciscan approach there. And that's why I do think that there needs to be, pro-life needs to be political, it needs to be personal, but it also needs to happen in the world of the arts.